I greet you in the name of the triune God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Please be seated. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
How many of you here have heard of Mike Tyson? Raise your hand if you've heard of Mike Tyson. Mike Tyson, the boxer. The boxer. Everybody has heard of Mike Tyson, so let me break it down. Mike Tyson was a boxer, but he wasn't a very big guy. They listed him at 5'11", but he was like 5'8", 5'9". He was muscular, but he wasn't huge. Mike Tyson, Iron Mike Tyson. He wrote a book published in 2013, Undisputed Truth. I had a discussion with a friend of mine about Mike Tyson. He told me that he thought that Mike Tyson wasn't a boxer at all. He said, Mike Tyson is just a brawler. Like, Mike Tyson just gets in the ring and acts like an animal. Mike Tyson is probably the most skilled boxer in boxing history. That's my biased opinion. That little fella would get in the ring, and he had this combination. His arms were way shorter than the average guy he fought. He would box people, and he'd stand right here to them. So he had to duck and weave. He had this way where he would bob this way, and then he'd duck under the punch, and he would hit. He had this combination where he would hit the guy in the ribs, bow! And then he'd lower his ribs, you know, everybody, he'd just hit him in the ribs, ugh. Then Mike Tyson, with that same hand, would come right up with the uppercut. You remember that? Yeah. Like it was real fast, like, bow! When Mike Tyson was a kid, he used to get teased for his effeminate voice. He would get bullied in the neighborhood. People picked on him all the time. And he said in his book that guys in his neighborhood would shadow box and he would imitate them. And one day, he had to get into a fight. He was forced into a fight. And Mike Tyson imitated the guys in the neighborhood. And he beat the boy up. Mike Tyson grew up in a rough neighborhood and he got in trouble. He was sent to some type of reform school for boys. And there he met a retired boxer named Custom Motto. And Custom Motto, Mike Tyson writes in his book that Custom Motto got inside of his mind. Custom Motto's goal was to turn Mike Tyson into a gladiator. Mike Tyson ate like a gladiator. He slept like a gladiator. He lived like a gladiator. He thought like a gladiator. He made himself a gladiator through his mind. Jesus Christ is trying to do the same thing to you. Jesus Christ is trying to do the same thing to you. Let us turn our attention to Luke, the 10th chapter. This is the third Sunday in a row that I'm preaching from the 10th chapter of Luke. Mm-hmm. We know what happened in the 10th chapter of Luke. He sent out, you know, how many people did he send out?
70.
He sent out 70 people in the 10th chapter of Luke. He had these 70 disciples who had been studying him. And when they went out into the world, they imitated him. You know, like Mike Tyson imitated those people who were shadow boxing his neighborhood. They imitated Jesus. They walked like Jesus. They talked like Jesus. They did what Jesus did. What did they do?
They cast out
demons. They healed the sick. They were the emissaries of Jesus through imitation. They believed that what Jesus did, they could do. And Jesus said, hey, this is great. But you know what you should be even happier about? You should be even happy. You should rejoice that your name is written in heaven. What you have done by imitating me, by embodying me, is that your name is now written in heaven. You have now touched eternal life. Then an expert at the law. Are you guys okay? Let us stay focused. I think you distracted. I think you're distracted. Are you distracted?
No.
Then an expert of the law said to Jesus, "What must I do to inherit eternal life?" And he said, "Well, you're an expert of the law. You know what the law says." He said, "Yes. Love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, all thy mind, all thy soul. And treat your neighbor as yourself." I said, "Okay." Then he said, "Well, Jesus, who is my neighbor?" Remember, he tried to trip Jesus up, and he told him the story of the Good Samaritan. The story of the Good Samaritan. This is how you teach it at BTS, right? The Good Samaritan was an Episcopalian. The first one came by was an Episcopal priest, right? Then an Episcopalian came by. And then somebody who didn't go to church at all came by. And he saw that man laying in the gutter. And he risked his life and helped him. And Jesus said, "Who was that man's neighbor?" "The one who showed mercy." And Jesus said, "Go and do likewise." See, Jesus was on a roll in the 10th chapter of Luke. He was teaching. He was preaching. He was giving his power away to the people. Then he came to a house. It was the house of Martha and Mary. You see, Martha, how can I put it? Martha liked, she liked having get-togethers. She liked having parties. She liked having company. Martha was a host. You know, I think about Martha and Mary. You know, people come to church every Sunday, and they may come just because their dad makes them come. Yeah. And they focus on coffee hour and bagels and donuts. There may be people right now. I'll tell you what, I've been to churches before, not this church, where folks come and they sit in the parish hall the whole time, hang out and socialize, and don't learn anything about the Word of God. They are distracted. The scripture said that Martha was distracted. There are people who come to church every day for a whole bunch of reasons other than learning the Word of God. And they are distracted. They may be distracted by their brother. They might be distracted by, not this church, foolishness, triviality. They may just come for the coffee hour and the socializer. They don't come for the Word of God. There's people in this room right now who may be distracted. There's someone in this room right now who is distracted. There's someone in this room, I don't even have your attention. There's someone in this room right now who has their mind on something else besides the Word of God. They're not thinking about Luke. They're not thinking about Ephesians. They're thinking about something else. I ask your attention in this moment. I ask your attention in this moment. Mary was distracted by many things. In this moment, do not be Mary. In this moment, open up your mind to the Word of God. We are surrounded by a world of wickedness. We are surrounded by evil. We are surrounded by so much wickedness and so much evil, you're used to being distracted, because if you thought about what was going on, you might lose your mind. We live in a place that drops bombs on human beings for freedom. We send people around the world to fight for democracy. It doesn't matter if they ask for it or not. Make sense to you? We live in a place where increasing numbers of African Americans are being imprisoned while we have an African American president. Nobody in this room, there are people, so I heard, who go into debt to look wealthy. Go into debt to look wealthy to impress people they don't even like. distracted. Because it doesn't make sense. I ask for your attention right now because I want you to know that you are the thinker who thinks the thought that makes the thing. You are the thinker who thinks the thought that makes the thing. Now, some of us get distracted. Some of us get stuck in our old thought pattern and we can't move forward. In this moment, I want you to understand who you are. I want you to understand your power in the world. Ephesians said we are fighting wickedness in high places. Pick up the shield of faith. What is the shield of faith? The shield of faith is not somewhere way out there. The shield of faith is that energy that already surrounds you. It is knowing that there is energy that surrounds you. And then taking that energy and focusing it. Now let me tell you this. You've done it before. You do it all the time. But you have these distractions. You have these distractions that come from the wickedness of the world that makes you forget that you are so powerful. This is what Jesus' message was. This is what the 70 imitated. Jesus preached in such a way he got into folks' imaginations the way the custom motto got in Mike Tyson's imagination. That's how they can walk and tell demons to obey them. That's the power that you have. I ask your attention right now because I want you to know that you have power. You come to church, but what are you getting out of church? Mary had Jesus in her house. What did Mary do? She sat at Jesus' feet and she learned. Mm-hmm. Martha, God bless her soul. Mary, could you come in here and put some of this food on the plate for me? Can you cut some of this meat up? Can you pour the wine in the glasses for me? What are you doing, Mary? Martha missed it. You can come to church every Sunday and still participate and replicate the wickedness of the world. If you don't open your mind and allow yourself to be transformed by the word of God. Amen. I got one amen. I didn't hear everybody say amen on that.
Amen.
But I mean, like, we don't have, that doesn't happen at this church. But there are places where you go, people come to church every Sunday, and that just is wicked and just evil. Like, my goodness, why are you here? Like, they can't, you know. You've seen it in other places. When people come to church, just that kind of foolish. I had a parishioner tell me, she said, those people, they're not negative. They're just stuck. They're just stuck. Martha was stuck. She was stuck in a paradigm of being a hostess. She was stuck in a paradigm of the party. She was stuck in a paradigm of trying to impress Jesus and all the folks there. That's what Martha was. Mary said, you know what? I don't care what's going on. I want to be transformed. I like what he's saying. I want to be like him. I want to have my mind transformed. I want to be a better person. I want to conquer all these problems that surround me. There may be someone in this room right now who's dealing with a health problem. There may be someone in this room who's dealing with a sickness. There may be someone in this room who is worried about tomorrow. I want you to know that health belongs to you. That happiness belongs to you. That your strength is real. In this moment, I invite you to focus on these words. Focus on the 10th chapter of Luke and go home and read it again and then read it again and again. Imitate Jesus. You have the power to change the world. Not just yourself, but the entire world. A little bit at a time. This is the message of Jesus. Martha went to talk to Jesus. She said, I'm mad. I'm mad at my sister Mary. You know what we're trying to do here. We try to make sure that the acolytes process properly. We try to make sure that we have a good coffee hour. We got to make sure that Marilyn sings this song properly. That's why we're here. But that's why we're here. That's the point. No, that's not the point. Martha, that's not the point, Martha. That's not the point. The point is to be transformed by the word of God. You know, Martha, you are, you know, Mary chose the better part. But Martha, you are overwhelmed. You are stuck, worried about a whole bunch of things. But there is only one thing that should be on your mind. My brothers and sisters, there is only one thing that should be on your mind, and that's being transformed by the word of God. We're fighting wickedness at high places, but you are more than well equipped. You have the power of God and the word of Jesus Christ to transform you. Amen.
Amen.